Welcome everyone to the Coach Training EDU Coaching to Flourish podcast. Welcome, Christine. It is such a pleasure to see you. How are you?
Ah, I feel wonderful. Yeah, such a pleasure to talk together, John. Yeah.
It's fun. And I'm just excited on many different levels. One of them to bring this community together and to have this time to share and for them to learn more about you, what you're up to. And in this time of, you know, this change, looking at, you know, what we can do to be more resilient as part of this resilience series. So thank you, Christine. I know today I would love to introduce you, give you a short introduction, and then let's launch. First off, Christine is one of Coach Training EDU's trainers based in Basel, Switzerland. She has a PhD laureate, and a professional certified coach through the ICF. On your way to master certified coach, and 20 years, over 20 years experience working with organizations and business development in Switzerland. Christine, pleasure to have you. Today, we're going to look at learning, unlearning, and what that is. So we'll spend the first half hour here learning about your story. We'll move into ideas and ideas of coaching concepts, what you're up to now, and then we'll spend the last 20 minutes in Q&A. Let's get started. Christine, how are you? How are things?
I feel really great. And I was just thinking that, yeah, this is a key topic. Yeah? I've been doing different trainings today about resilience. And yeah, I'm very happy that we chose the topic of learning and learning. Yeah.
Right. Absolutely. So we've met in person, although we are on different continents. I came to Basel. You're one of the directors of the ICF in Switzerland, and that was lovely. And I remember that train ride that we had from Lugano to Zurich, and we got to chat. We got to really sit down and have this beautiful train ride through the Swiss Alps. What do you see, or where do you see the state of coaching in Switzerland right now, and what most excites you about where coaching's at? Mm-hmm.
So I think I discovered, coaching during my career. And I realized the power it has in terms of helping us to unlearn. So I would say, to answer your question, I think at the specific moment, now that we are living in a crisis, in kind of urgency to find our way, coaching is really a great tool to help all of us to let go about the past and to plan for the future. So I really see that coaching has a lot to offer at the moment in Switzerland, in Europe, in the world, to overcome this crisis and to reinvent ourselves, hein? So to redesign ourselves, to prepare for long-term success, to benefit from this situation. So coaching is well used in US and less used in Europe at the moment. And this crisis offers, from that perspective, a great opportunity for us to have more impact, to help each other. So this is, I think, a great place to be at the moment, to be a coach and to help people who need it.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, I remember just seeing the beautiful countryside in the chat that we had about the future of coaching. What does this look like? What's it going to look like 10 years from now? And feeling this level of excitement. Let's take a step back and go to the beginning. Where did you grow up, and how did that influence who you've become today?
Yeah, so as you guess from my accent, for you online who don't know me yet, I'm from France, and I was born in Paris. And I live in Paris for 30 years before traveling around the world and living in different places, including US, in the center of Europe. And that had a big influence because I was born really close to a place in Paris where all people who are, you know, want to fight for their rights, they go in the street and they start there, right? So basically, I was observing from a very young age these people, you know, fighting in the street. And basically, preparing the future, advocating for the future. So not accepting, you know, the present, just thinking that it could be better and advocating for it. So I think this has really a big impact on me to say, no, just, you know, it's okay. The past is great. It's not about rejecting it, but it could be somehow different if we want. So that has always been with me. And I think through my life with different, you know, situation, I adopted automatically this way of accepting and then planning for the future. So this is something that is in me and helps me a lot with this experience also to help others to accept and to plan for the future.
I was really impressed with your ability, like the emphasis you had on community building in Basel, mm-hmm. and in Switzerland in general, in France. You know, this, you know, Basel's on the border, and it's this combination of culture. Where do you see, or like, what's that? Where does that community come from? Like your sense is, it's there. I mean, it was really impressive to see how many people from so many different places you were bringing together. Mm. Yeah, I love to hear more about where that comes from and where you see it going.
Yeah, I like to be with people and I like to feel the atmosphere of people with different backgrounds, different ideas coming together and creating something new. So I am a connector. I really enjoy when I can connect people and I know that through this discussion they will create something. So again, it's the idea about not feeling stuck in the present, but really planning for the future. I get a lot of motivation, excitement about this, to observe that, to be part of it. So yeah, this is very natural to me to set up this community. And I like to live at the border. So I live currently in France, close to the Swiss border and the German border at the center of Europe. And for me, it's not by chance. It's really because, yeah, a lot of people are crossing the border and bringing new ideas, you know, coming from different countries. And there is a mix. It's a very creative place. It's a place where you don't stay in the what you have learned, you know. You get new questions, you get challenged, and this is what I like. Yeah. So I will always create this community because I like the challenge of these interactions. Yeah.
Oh, that's lovely. When did you first find coaching and what was your first impression of it?
Wow, I think I did it without knowing it. Right. The first, you know, I came from an idea to transfer my knowledge initially, so the teaching part. Always wanted to help people to get new knowledge, understanding, facilitate their path. So this was more from the helping, you know, approach. And then in the workplace, in big companies, I was asked to support innovation. And I realized that people always have the energy to move forward, but they don't always know from where they start, okay? So what is the question? What they are trying to achieve? So, you know, they put a lot of energy on the way, but will they get what they want? Mm-hmm. So this clarity was missing. So my role was to help people to really better understand, okay, what they were trying to achieve. So I developed this attitude of asking questions instead of providing, you know, ideas. So asking questions and yeah, so moving in a curiosity place and helping people to sit together for a while until they get aligned, if it's a team, or aligned with themselves before they can, you know, start their journey. So that was the shift for me, intuitive shift. I understood the power was in the question.
Right.
And not in the solution. No.
Right, right. What was your favorite coaching tool in the training?
It's a reframing, you know, so revisiting, you know, what you believe, using, you know, fun to challenge your belief. So reframing, so I developed a tool around reframing where, you know, people come with their question, but you change the words and you see what difference it makes. So you change your perspective.
Yeah, I love reframing. It's a fun tool. It's a fun, quick tool that really that mm-hmm. tends to open up a lot of other things yeah. for people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What's your if let's say someone's starting out, they're just starting out coach training. What would be your advice that you'd give them?
Be curious. Mm. Be open. Be curious. Like a kid.
Right.
Because for me. Getting into a coaching training is unlearning. So what happened to me is that, you know, I learned, you know, in school, in university, I became a scientist and I had a lot of opinions on things and I was paid for that, okay, to be an expert. And I realized that in a way, this was good and in another way, it was not because I was blocked by being convinced of knowing, okay? And in reality, the more you learn, you realize you don't know a lot, huh? You only know a part of it. So coaching was great for me because it helps me to unlearn and to start fresh again. And this is great. So I think it's really come with a curiosity like a kid and yeah, be ready for a fresh start. Yeah.
Love that. When did you get your first client? Like what was the time that you got that first paying client after starting the training?
Ah, yes, I remember. So when you are in the training, you are, you know, a student, so you don't get paid. At the beginning, it's pro bono. You are practicing. At one point, a person said, okay, I need to pay you. I want to pay you. Because this is adding a lot of value to me, and I can't live like this without paying you. So if you don't allow me to pay you, I don't come again.
So that's amazing. Congrats.
So I was like, oh, right. I have no choice because, you know, I wanted to support the person and she was getting, you know, value from it. So that was a turning point during the training. You know, I you know, I got this feedback and that was very nice. Yeah.
What did that reframe? That's lovely. What did that reframe? Like what reframed in your mind?
It's about the value. Huh? It's about the value, the confidence. Huh? It's you develop a new activity, and at the beginning you are not sure. It's normal, but then you get this feedback, and this is really thinking, okay, this has really, yeah, I can do it. This has value.
And clients show up differently when they're paying too. It's yeah. part of the magic of. Mm. Coaching, because they're invested in the process too.
Yeah.
What was the journey like from that first paying client to like your first five? Because that's often the toughest road from one to five. What was that journey like for you?
I really believed in coaching. It was so powerful for me as a transformation, this you know, unlearning thing that I really wanted to share, you know, I mean, to help people to experience it. Huh? So I was very determined. So I reached out, I asked people, and yeah, I tried in different ways. So, you know, through people I knew in my network, when I was doing other activities, because at one point I was transferring from project management science to coaching. So doing a mix of both. So I was very active to reach out. And I got clients from the other activity I was doing. So I was doing trainings in project management. And people were interested because they saw the coaching skills during the training. They could feel it and they could see how it could make a positive difference in their, you know, project management activity as well. So it started like this. Yeah.
And now 3,000 hours later.
almost. I am, as you said, I am on my way to MCC, to Master Coach, and I have accumulated a lot of hours with great pleasure. It's never the same. I mean, I'm so happy about, I continue to learn and unlearn each time, you know. I meet with a client, I talk with another coach, I train, you know, I get new questions, a lot of reframing, as you said, a lot of unlearning. So it never stops.
What's the biggest thing you've had to unlearn from beginning coach to where you are now?
My perspective on understanding. From an expert perspective, I know, I'm the expert.
Right.
To, you know, we know together, this partnership.
What's an insight feel like? Like when we get into, like, let's say we get to an insight. When do you know, like, how much of that insight, or like, if you just look at insights and this idea of learning, unlearning. Like, what are your thoughts on the percentage split? Like if we were in a laboratory, we had to create an insight. How much of that insight do you think comes from the unlearning of things versus the learning of other things?
It's a big shift. I remember how fascinated I was when I was in the lab and I was the first one to discover something. There is a fascination when you done an experiment and you see the result appearing in front of your eyes. You're like, oh, you know, you're the first one. Okay. So you see the things appearing in front of you. And you are like a kid like this, and you observe what you see, and you think you know, because you have designed the experiment in a way that it will reveal something to you. Right. And you realize it's only one perspective of it. So the posture of knowing will be, ah, now I see this. It's one dimension, this result in front of my eyes, and I know. It's in stone, you know, written in stone. That's why if you look around, if you see things in a more holistic way, right? Designing a different experiment, or, you know, somebody else doing it and observing, or, you know, changing things, you know, changing the perspective on it, you will discover that you don't know. You know a part of it. So that's the difference between I know because I see it right now from we know because we together, me or looking at different perspectives, we see different parts of it.
Right. It's the value of coaching comes from someone listening empathetically from a different perspective. They see the other half, they see the other side, the insight that's there. When you're training, because I mean, you're a trainer. When do you feel like that light bulb goes off for new coaches? Or what's the insight do you feel like new coaches are waiting for?
Yeah, there are great moments when you know, this happened to me and all the students, we are stuck, you know. We share something, we explain something, we demonstrate something, but we are not yet having that inside, this inner understanding of what it means. So this is, you know, the integration of, you know, the tool or you know, the approach to make your own. So it's beautiful to see the students, you know, stuck, and then suddenly, because you said it in a different way, because of the, you know, what you just observe, you know, you doing, they get it. So it's like, you know, they are looking for opening, awareness, ownership of this tool or this approach. Because for example, you can talk for hours about listening. You can explain what is listening. You can show what is listening. And you are not yet able to do it because you have to feel it inside. So I would answer to your question saying, you know, it's about feeling. I think students are looking for feeling looking for the feeling.
Right. Yeah. There's something around like when people first jump into level two listening, like what does level two listening, it feels different from level one. There's just a different internal landscape, it feels like, they tap into. It also seems like there's a great degree of unlearning that happens in that first initial. You get to unlearn to listen to yourself, listen to chatter mind, and to learn and lean into listening into other mind, right? What's it? How would you describe that moment when you know that you're listening level two?
I was stuck to the listening level one, which is, you know, listening, I mean, preparing what you are going to say or this kind of thing for many, many years because I believe that what was going there is this expert mindset, okay, that sometimes blocks you to open for, you know, other perspectives. What was helpful for me was to tap into my motivation for learning, for understanding, for broadening the perspective. Voilà. I think that's what it is. Broadening the perspective was so attractive for me so that I could let go about my perspective, my own perspective, and be curious about what was going on in the mind of the person without thinking about my own. So there is so much to get from that, from the other.
Right. It feels like a whole new world opens up. A whole new landscape is available. When do you know a feeling you're feeling is more about your client than yourself?
It feels so connected. It feels like it's one mind.
Right.
We are not separated. So there is this authentic curiosity and happiness, I would say, and confidence, trust, all of that, which makes everything possible, anything possible. So then the coaching is so easy.
Right. It's like once that level of listening is there, the coaching session coaches itself. It's all about putting all the energy and attention into pure listening or unfiltered, like it's filtered listening because you're filtering out yourself, right? And you're just other, 100% other. I love that moment when participants feel that. You know what I mean? They come back from a session and like you see a brightness in their eyes and they seem to be like, I got it. Like, this is amazing. What would you like? So let's get to the topic, learning, unlearning. What's what has been a recent insight, or what are the insights that you would love to share about learning, unlearning?
You know, in my journey to master coach, I haven't learned a lot again. So I think it's the process is that you are revealing a lot and you are broadening the perspective. So it's like you are seeing things almost like an helicopter, you know, view. So this listening level 3, where you are really observing, okay, yourself, the client, and, you know, all the surroundings. And so you don't see things precisely in details. You see them all interconnected. And because you see them all interconnected, what was appearing complex at the beginning becomes very clear. So it's broadening. So the unlearning is removing the details. Okay, if I can summarize it like this, removing the details of what you know. To make a very nice painting. Yes, let's maybe take this metaphor. You know, when you are, you know, it's like it's full of different colors, and you can only see what it means if you you know, step away from it, and then it reveals the message. If you are too close to it, you see the colors, but you don't yet see the message. So you step away from what you know and what you are attached to, maybe the details, to see things in a more holistic way.
That's sometimes scary. Like, you know, like releasing everything you know, you know, getting into that place of unknown, the unknowing. What? But you seem to go there with such joy, like,
yeah.
To jump in. What helps you jump in with joy into that place that's often scary?
Because I feel that I will see this beautiful picture,
right.
And I want to see it. It is there, I know. So I have no question in my mind. So it's not a problem to detach from the detail of the expertise. I can come back to it if I want, in the future, why not? I think we are navigating into cycles, you know, of expertise and then generalist and then expertise, and it's okay. It's like pieces of the puzzle, huh? Oh yeah, let me explore this and then yeah, step. So I think there is a power in the zoom in and zoom out. That's another way to see it. There are times you want to zoom in, times you want to zoom out. So I think our happiness and our success depends on this feeling or ability to sense when it's good to zoom in or it's good to zoom out.
That's just beautiful, this idea that you're holding space
for
them. You're holding the space of beautiful painting for them, and that's happening in the background.
Mm-hmm.
This, your curiosity is really this engine that takes them from place to, you know, place to place.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's beautiful. Let's look at some questions too. We'll still keep going in this, but mm-hmm. any questions, please use the Q&A. Any further questions on this, learn this ideas of learning on learning, you can go to the CoachTrainEDU blog, ask questions. Let's keep going, Christine. This is great. So what are some of your favorite default questions as a coach? Like, what questions do you love to ask?
What's in your mind?
That's a nice one. All right. What else? What are a couple of your favorites that you have in your pocket?
I like to use fun. I like the contrasting questions. So for example, what is the benefit of, feeling stuck or not knowing or being lost? We say in coaching, evoke, not provoke, but evoke. And there is an energy in that you can provide with positive intention, with fun. So even in very serious situation, if you can bring a small dose of, fun and turn it into something lighter, I think that helps a lot. Right. So this is my way. Depersonalizing also, if you were an animal, for example, people start to laugh sometimes. Well, 2 seconds before they were not laughing at all. And I think this is, helping to change the energy, redirecting the energy into something positive, powerful for them. Yeah, it's something I like to see. Yeah.
That's lovely. I love that. Yeah, the questions about opposite day or unusual, right? Mm-hmm. What's the benefit of this seemingly negative thing, or what's mm-hmm. the downside to this seemingly positive thing? Love those questions. All right, we have our first question in the Q&A.
Yeah.
From me. Mm-hmm. Could you talk more about zooming in and out?
Yeah, I say yes like this because for me it's the same. Okay, I think. As a scientist, I have used microscopes to really zoom in, in the details of the cells, the part of our bodies, really in a very tiny places, I will say. And when you look at the stars, at night, I realize that it's the same. Okay, so there is no difference. So that's why we shouldn't be scared about zooming or zoom out, because it's the same. So from time to time, we like to zoom in or zoom out to approach it from different perspectives, but it's all in interaction, in connection, which is each other in equilibrium. Okay. So, maybe what we see in space is representing a cell of the body. It's the same organization. Everything is in equilibrium. So it's a change of perspective that can be powerful. For us, it's sometimes easier to look at, the small things instead of space.
Right. What's an example of a zoom in question, versus a zoom out question? Mm-hmm. Let's say I'm working on my 2 weeks, I have project schedules, time. What would be a question that you would ask a client like me? Mm-hmm. That would be a zoom out question. And then what's a zoom in question?
Mm-hmm. So I would, for example, ask you, okay, so in this present moment, how do you feel in the shoulders? Okay, so the zoom in, you know, it's like
in pretty good. I
the
feel
field.
like, yeah, I feel, ooh, got this.
Inside
Yeah.
Of you, inside of you, huh? And a question of zoom out would be, well, if you were in an helicopter, or if you were a hawk, or how would you perceive the situation?
Right, yeah, takes me someplace else. It takes me like away, looking at the whole, like bigger spot, like bigger space.
Yeah,
yeah, absolutely. Mm. Yeah, I love it. So I gotta go into it. I can't help it. I studied Greek. I studied ancient Greek in college, the geekiest stuff. And I wrote my thesis on hoplite warfare. Homer does this amazing job of getting really detailed, talking about the specifics of the armor, the sword, the jewels on the sword, like really detailed into it. And then, you know, the next stanza, taking it out and looking over the whole vast army that look like, you know, wheat in the winds that are like swaying back and forth, and you see this vast landscape. That to me feels like zoom in, zoom out. Like I always, when we were talking about this, I was like, I guess I gotta share. It's like, it's one of my favorite metaphors, and Homer does a really good job of it.
Yeah.
But I feel like as coaches, this is an opportunity for us, right? To zoom in, just like you did, really, really quickly. Let's keep going. Sandra, how are you? Is this the Sandra I know from Fossil? Sandra in the Q&A? I think it is. Sandra has a question. Has there been a specific moment where you, Christine, were thinking, yes, I am ready, and all the uncertainty you might have had as a coaching student is gone? And if yes, do you remember this moment? And please share.
So all the uncertainty gone. So for me, it relates to the definition of uncertainty. And I would relate that to the comfort zone. So in coaching, we improvise. So we prepare ourselves by you know, being in the present moment, being there in the mind. And when we are there with the client, we are in a comfortable zone, I would say, comfortable because we are confident. We are, you know, we believe that we have all the resources we need in ourselves, the client has, and we believe in the process. So we have all we need. And at the same time, when we start to talk together, we sometimes are destabilized, okay? Because, for example, I ask a question, the client didn't expect the question. So there is a, you destabilize, okay? So it's uncertain. And then you move towards, you know, something new. So you are navigating all the time between stability and instability, and, you know, comfortable, not comfortable. So the uncertainty is always there. And as you practice coaching, you get more and more comfortable with that and expecting that and looking forward. And then you get more bold in your question.
Yeah, yeah.
Huh? So, yeah, I think it's when the uncertainty becomes a pleasure, an expectation, yeah, feeling comfortable with the uncomfortable, which will happen at, because you will destabilize. You will be destabilized at one point.
What was the moment, or like, do you remember the moment when that happened for you, when you felt comfortable in the unknowing, or in the trust, like when you knew that you can lean into trust, the coaching process?
Yeah, I think it's as an expert, when I was an expert before, it was very uncomfortable when you were getting a question you didn't know about, you didn't know how to answer. As a coach, it's the opposite. Huh? You enjoy not knowing, and to answer your question, how I shifted from being comfortable to know and to being comfortable not to know, it's because I said, wow, this is great because I learn more. So again, the link to my personal motivation to learn, I mean to understand, to get awareness of things. And understanding this comes from this opening the space. It can't come if you restrict the space to what you know. You are blocked. You are stuck. When you know, you are stuck, okay? To summarize, yeah.
I think a lot of new coaches, they want to, and myself when I was new, it's about problem hunting. It's about, let me try to find this problem that we can solve in this coaching conversation so I can prove the value of coaching. Right. And it seems like a milestone for any coach is when they let go of that. Like, when did you let go of problem hunting? Or what was the moment that you felt like you let go of problem hunting?
When you focus on the moment, on the process, and not on the outcome. Hein? So basically, you believe more in the what's happening right now than what will happen in 1 hour.
Right.
So, you are more interested by the process than by the result. And that's the same thing as saying you are more interested by the question than by the solution. You are more interested by the machine in the lab instead of the result.
Takes tremendous trust in the process. You need to trust that the end result will be there if you focus on present in this question.
Right. Yeah, it's the same. You know, it's the same as saying, you know, I trust life, you know. Because you are alive at the moment.
Mm-hmm. I love that. All right, so we have another question. During this particular time of social distancing, what do you think will be the future challenge to solve from a coaching perspective or coaching point of view to bring people to connect again?
What I observe is that people... they need this connection. So a lot of my clients are suffering from, you know, this feeling of being disconnected, isolated. And it's a challenge because they were used to a certain way of interacting with people and also interacting with themselves. And then now they are suddenly projected into something different and they have to adjust quickly. And the coaching helps because through the questioning, from the presence, the listening, we help people to get into the benefit of it. So I think that this is an opportunity for people to discover coaching and to feel the benefit of it. Because there is a clear need. There is a clear need there for all of us.
Right, right. That's lovely. Let me have another question here too. And this is from Sandra. This is Sandra Alaman. So this is the Sandra that, hi Sandra, how are you? How's it going? I know I know you sent me a note. I'll get back to you. So this is the Sandro I met in Switzerland, and we had a day to play, a couple of days together to play, mm-hmm. and to get into coaching and to really get, you know, and to see, you know, talk coaching. You have a whole floor in this building where people, it's almost like an open invitation where people can arrive, and that's where you hold your coaching classes, mm-hmm. meetings, coaching sessions. I mean, it just felt like this little, this coaching hub, which is what you crafted.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you see, or let's say we extrapolate this, like where do you see coaching hub or ideas of coaching hub going in Switzerland?
Mm-hmm. So when this was created, it came from, you know, I approached clients and coaches in Switzerland a few years ago, and I asked them, okay, what is working well? What is missing for you? What could we do about it? And people, and I summarized that, and people wanted a place where they could come spontaneously, meet other coaches, discover coaching, very open, you know, coming and going. And so this was the idea of Coaching Hub. And it started small. Now, and I hope you can see that when you come next, John, I have moved to another place. We have more space there. So it's really about helping people to benefit from coaching, to understand what is professional coaching, and for the coaches also to help each other, having this community where we can grow together. So the philosophy is growing together. And my personal vision is to make coaching accessible to all. So yeah, so it's nice to see coaching developing profession that is delivering value and where we all help each other to develop our skills and to have a happy and successful life. Yeah.
Right. That'll be fun. I can't wait. I'd love to see the new space. I will admit to missing that stair climb, though. There were five floors up or something like that. So everyone who arrived, it was always this, you made it. You have energized your body. You're now ready for coaching or coach training, whatever it is. You've gone five flights. How many stairs is that? Good job, everyone.
Yeah.
You made it. Yeah. Here we are. So Sandra's question, what helped me to unlearn with confidence during the coach training 1 and 2 with Christine and change limiting beliefs was the link to my why. With who I was meant to be, so passion may help us as well to unlearn. What are your thoughts and feelings on this idea of passion?
The idea of the why, yeah. Mm-hmm. It all starts with your passion. I think we are all unique. We have our why, and we need to reveal it. It's a diamond inside. This is what, I mean, yes, this is our reason to be. And getting this clarity is very powerful. It's, talking with your heart. And this is how you communicate with others. You engage others with your vision. It's a movement. It's a very powerful movement. It's how you feel unstoppable. So having this why, this vision, if there is an obstacle on the way, like there is at the moment, let's be realistic, you take it, you accept it, you take it, and you say, okay, what can I do with that to achieve my vision? So you use the obstacle as a building block because you have a long-term vision. And this is also my motivation as a coach, as a trainer, is to help people to really have this inner understanding of the why, which is so powerful.
Right. No, I love that. Anytime you start talking about passion, Christine, like your energy just skyrockets. So I have another question from Sandra. How has the coaching journey had an impact on you as a person so that you've started behaving differently?
It had a huge impact in helping me feeling more grounded, feeling more aligned between my brain, which was very powerful, to the heart, and being able to have a more direct communication, to feel more confident, getting new friends, setting up this new community, and it feels so great, So I remember the first session, coaching session, and also jumping, almost jumping into the practice. That you don't need to have a lot of knowledge to start to practice. Also, it's very important. So helping you to move forward.
One more question. This is a great one to end on. We'll conclude here. So more questions, please go to the blog in the Q&A and comments and Christine is leading a workshop coming up. When's the workshop, Christine? Is it next
Next
Wednesday?
next Tuesday,
Next Tuesday, and all the details will be on the Coach Training EDU blog. We'll send out another email with it on this idea of learning, unlearning, and in adjusting, right? Adjusting to working from home and tips and tricks from what this new environment is offering us. So we have another question from I believe it's pronounced Alaria, which is beautiful. It comes from, is this, I mean, it comes from the Latin meaning cheerful or lovely. It's a lovely name. This is a question for both of us. What is the curiosity? She says, this is the question for both of you and mainly a curiosity. What is the main difference of people approach to coaching on the different continents? Right? What are your thoughts, Christine? What do you see?
Alors, we could say here in Europe, we have different countries with slightly different culture, and I believe people are they have that in common that when they have an issue, a problem, they want to find a way. So they won't necessarily think about coaching at first in Europe, from my perspective, because we are very used to develop solutions. So this idea of that you have all the resources in yourself to find your way is still provocative, for many people. And so there is maybe a resistance at the beginning, but when they try it, they like it. They adopt it usually.
I found I would agree. I think the initial skepticism in Switzerland is a bit stronger than I think in the US, although there is a high degree of that as well in the US. Yes, there was, I have some of the prickliest questions I think I've received as a speaker came from people in Zurich and a couple in Basel too, but once they got it, once I feel like once the click happened, they saw what the process was, that then I just felt like it just was like anywhere else. Like it just opened up completely. But it feels like it's catching on. It feels like coaching, like there was an awareness of what it is, what it does, and the usefulness of it that feels surprisingly similar to me. Maybe like, I don't know, half, like a couple of years, like the field matures, right? And maybe Switzerland is a couple of years behind the US, but not, I mean, it feels like there's a high degree of sophistication in the coaching market, even in Switzerland too. Yeah, I thought surprisingly not much. I would expect there would have been more. Yeah, it's a great question. So thank you, everyone. Thank you for this Coaching and Flourish podcast. I do have two announcements. One, Christine is giving a workshop next week. Please attend. More details in the blog. And two, this Coaching to Flourish webinar is also a podcast. So we got officially approved to be the Coaching to Flourish podcast. You can see, able to listen to replays of all these webinars and interviews that we do in the Resiliency Series. So we're going to be on Google's podcast, Spotify, Apple Podcasts. You can subscribe. And if you give us 5-star reviews, please, at the beginning, it really helps us out. It helps us get listed, I guess. And that would really help us out tremendously. Thank you for being here. Thank you for listening. Christine, it's an absolute pleasure to have this conversation with you. Thank you so much for being here and being a part of this coach training community, sharing your passion, your wisdom. Get more of you next week. And
Thank you
thank you,
so
everyone.
much. Thank you for all of you to attend.
And this concludes our Coaching to Flourish podcast. Thanks, everyone. Bye now.
Bye-bye.